Hey there, my name is Xavier, and you might have read articles online saying that cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin uses enormous amounts of electricity to secure their networks. But why is that? And more importantly, what are the alternatives? Mining new coins takes a lot of computing power because of the proof-of-work algorithm. The idea was first introduced in 1993 to combat spam emails and was formally called proof-of-work in 1997. However, the technique went largely unused until Satoshi Nakamoto created Bitcoin in 2009. He realized that this mechanism could be used to reach consensus between many nodes on a network, and he used it as a way to secure the Bitcoin blockchain. However, the proof-of-work algorithm works by having all nodes solve a cryptographic puzzle. This puzzle is solved by miners, and the first one to find a solution gets the miner reward. And this has led to a situation where people are building larger and larger mining farms like this one. According to Digiconomist, Bitcoin miners alone uses about 54 terawatt hours of electricity, enough to power 5 million households in the US or even power the entire country of New Zealand or Hungary. But it doesn't stop there. Proof of work gives more rewards to people with better and more equipment. The higher your hash rate is, the higher the chance that you'll have to create the next block and thus receiving the mining reward. To increase chances even further, miners can come together in what's called mining pools. They combine their hashing power and distribute the awards evenly across everyone in the pool. So, to sum it up, proof of work is causing miners to use massive amounts of electricity, and it encourages the use of mining pools, which makes the blockchain more centralized as opposed to decentralized. So to solve these issues, we have to find a new consensus algorithm that is as effective or better than proof of work. In 2011, a Bitcoin Talk forum user called Quantum Mechanic proposed a new technique that he called proof of stake. The basic idea is that letting everyone compete against each other with mining is just wasteful. So instead, proof of work uses an election process in which one node is randomly chosen to validate the next block. Oh yeah, small difference in terminology here. Proof of stake has no miners, but instead has validators. And it doesn't let people mine new blocks, but instead mint or forge new blocks. Validators aren't chosen completely randomly. To become a validator, a node has to deposit a certain amount of coins into the network as stake. You can think of this as a security deposit. The size of the stake determines the chances of a validator to be chosen to forge the next block. It's a linear correlation. Let's say Bob deposits $100 into the network, while Alice deposits $1,000. Alice now has a 10 times higher chance of being chosen to forge the next block. This might not seem fair because it favors the rich, but in reality, it's more fair compared to proof of work. With proof of work, rich people can enjoy the power of economies at scale. The price they pay for mining equipment and electricity doesn't go up in a linear fashion. Instead, the more they buy, the better prices they can get. But back to proof of stake. If a node is chosen to validate the next block, he'll check if all the transactions within it are indeed valid. And if everything checks out, the node signs off on the block and adds it to the blockchain. As a reward, the node receives the fees that are associated with the transactions inside this block. Okay, but how can we trust other validators on the network? Well, that's where the stake comes in. Validators will lose a part of their stake if they approve fraudulent transactions. As long as the stake is higher than what the validator gets from the transaction fees, we can trust them to correctly do their job. Because if not, they'll lose more money than they'll gain. It's a financial motivator and holds up as long as the stake is higher than the sum of all the transaction fees. If a node stops being a validator, his stake plus all the transaction fees that he got will be released after a certain period of time. Not straight away, because the network still needs to be able to punish you should they discover that some of your blocks were actually fraudulent. So the difference between proof of work and proof of stake are quite significant. Proof of stake doesn't let everyone mine for new blocks and therefore uses considerably less energy. It's also more decentralized. How is that? Well, in proof of work, we have something called mining pools. Those are people who are teaming up to increase their chances of mining a new block and thus collecting a reward. However, these pools now control large portions of the Bitcoin blockchain. They centralize the mining process, and that could be very dangerous. If the three biggest mining pools would merge together, they would have a majority in the network and could start approving fraudulent transactions. Another important advantage is that setting up a node for a proof-of-stake-based blockchain is a lot less expensive compared to a proof-of-work-based one. You don't need expensive mining equipment, and thus proof-of-stake encourages more people to set up a node, making the network more decentralized and also more secure. But even proof-of-stake isn't perfect, and it also has some flaws. Now, you might think, hold on a minute, if I buy a majority stake in the network, I can effectively control it and approve fake transactions. And you would be correct. This is called the 51% attack, and it was first discussed as a weak point of the proof-of-work algorithm. If a single miner or group of miners can obtain 51% of the hashing power, they can effectively control the blockchain. Proof-of-stake, on the other hand, makes this attack very impractical depending on the value of a cryptocurrency. If Bitcoin would be converted to proof-of-stake, acquiring 51% of all the coins would set you back a whopping $79 billion. So the 51% is actually less likely to happen with proof-of-stake. But that's not the only risk. Proof-of-stake algorithms also have to be careful how they select the next validator. It cannot be completely random because the size of the stake has to be factored in. But at the same time, the stake alone isn't enough because that will favor rich people, who will get chosen more frequently, will collect more transaction fees, become even richer, and thus increase their chances of being chosen as a validator even further. There are a number of proposals to fix this, like coin age-based selection, for instance. Another potential problem is when the network chooses the next validator, but he doesn't turn up to do his job. This could easily be solved by choosing a large number of backup validators as a fallback. In short, proof-of-stake brings additional risks when compared to proof-of-work, and a lot of research is needed to understand these risks and then to mitigate them. Alright, so now that we know what proof-of-stake is, what benefits it has, what risks are involved, let's take a look at real-world usage. A few examples of coins that use it right now are Peercoin, Lisk, and NXT, but more cryptocurrencies are likely to follow in the future. Ethereum, for instance, is working on implementing a proof-of-stake system which they call Casper. It's currently deployed on the Ethereum testnet and is actively being developed. And also the Cardano project has long been working on creating a provable secure proof-of-stake algorithm that they call Ouroboros. More about that in this video right here. So that was it for this video. If you liked it, give it a thumbs up and consider getting subscribed. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.